Hi, welcome to Peaceworks, and I'm Heather Gallion. In this episode, we're going to hear from Saulo Padilla, and we asked some people the following question. Should we try to change laws that aren't compassionate?
I would say it really depends on the law, because most laws are there for the better of to help the citizens. They aren't there to hurt each other. It's kind of why we have laws, to prevent hurt. It's more of like the government trying to just help us protect each other. So I would say it is a good boundary to have at times. It really depends on the law. So,
yeah. Like, even though you're killing people or you're just breaking in just to get $1, it's not a good thing. So some laws can be changed, I think, but some laws are actually compassionate.
I guess it depends on what, but I mean, initially I want to say yes, because I think the world lacks a lot of compassion. But in terms of politics, religion, I think you won't ever really have it. People in power, I think, are there because they're not compassionate. So they have to fight to get to the top. And in order to change laws, I don't know that they would, because they may lose their role. Should we? Yes. But will it happen? Probably not.
Let's see what some others had to say about that.
My work is with Midnight Central Committee as an immigration education coordinator, and that takes me to different groups and within the United States. One of the things that we're facing right now in the United States is the issue of having 12 million people who are undocumented in the United States. And many people say undocumented, other people take it to the law and they say illegal people here in the United States. And one of the things that currently happens then is trying to figure out what to do with people who are coming. And for the church then it becomes an issue as we're trying to see within the law then how do we respond to the issue of having people who are undocumented in the United States. One of the first things that for me then my work is trying to figure out resources and learning opportunities and how do we respond to the issue of immigration in the United States. And the first thing is going back to scriptures and looking in scriptures that everybody is created in the image of God. And then looking at that from that angle, then it invites us to then respond to them in a way of welcoming each other in the image of God as well. So we can go back into scriptures and look at Abraham's story and then Moses and Joseph, and then looking at Joseph as a victim of human trafficking, that we often are reading scriptures and it is just a passing through, and we want to get to the end of the story, but we never stop and really think Joseph was a victim of human trafficking and how bad that was for Jacob also to not know, you know, how where his son was. And so we want to get to when he was in Egypt already as a prince or you know, but never stop to look at what happened in between all these things here. So then looking at the Bible through a lens of migration or immigration then is very important in our community so that we can get a lens of how do we understand the Bible of these people who are moving through their stories and how God is acting in those stories as they're moving through. So then for me, providing those opportunities for people to, and resources to, for people to know a little bit more about immigration and resettlement and how do we, as the church, respond to people who are on the move, at the risk of moving as well, or who have arrived already, how do we respond to them as well once they come. In the Bible, we find that God has in his heart a special place for the migrant, for the stranger, and there's always an invitation for doing that. In the Hebrew scriptures, we find that God always tells about retelling the story of when the Hebrews were slaves in Egypt, and then how that informs in the future, how they will treat the orphan, the widow, and the stranger. And I think we have stopped at some point telling the stories. Many people in our communities do not know their story of where they come from. And many people in our communities at this point feel as they're the owners of this land at this point. But then if we can start looking back, a few generations back, they can see that at some point their ancestors were strangers as well here and how they were treated. So then we don't want to repeat some of the errors that we have done in the past. So planting seeds for the future in our new generations, I think, is very important. So telling the stories to our kids of our migration is very important. And then for the Anglo communities also to remember where they come from. So that is part of my work then, taking these resources and speaking in different groups about how do we build that as well. Also speaking about the root causes of migration. Many times within our communities, we speak about migration without talking about what causes people to move and how do we respond to that. So I think in the future, we need to look at how do we respond to the root causes of migration. How are our foreign policies, political in some ways, but then the church also being part of some of those decisions sometimes. How do we can we influence our decisions in our governments? And in Canada, we have many companies that are Latin America, mining companies that are displacing people, gold companies that are displacing people up in the mountains in Guatemala and different places in Latin America. How can we influence that? Maybe the ways that they're doing that can be a little bit different. And then in the United States as well, through free commerce or free trade with Latin America, how can we influence that within the church? And the church, I think, has the power and has also the call to be influencing government in some ways so that can respond better in some sense. So that's the other part of my work, educating people about root causes of migration and how do we respond to the things that cause migration and push people out of their countries into new lands. And then trying to work on advocacy as well. How do we encourage governments to change the laws? And sometimes within the church, many times we get hooked into or stuck in the issue that in Romans 13 it says that everybody should submit to the government. And I think that is true. We could do that once the laws are working fine for us. At this point, the immigration laws here in the United States are not working fine. The last five presidents of the United States have said that we have a broken immigration system. So then it needs to, the laws need to be fixed, right? So we can all be under the law and submit under the law. So then when we talk as Christians about scripture and the current status of the laws, then we have to reevaluate laws in the United States and fix them and revisit some laws that are not working anymore for our context. And that's, I think, it's a very Christian thing to do. Jesus often, he said, you have heard this, right? An eye for an eye, but I tell you this now. Let's try this different law here of loving your enemies. So how do we practice that as well, of revisiting laws in a way that they work for us? I think our current systems and that are in place are not really helping us very much to get along with each other. So building peace through also doing advocacy with government and touching in the issues that are very important for the church as well are things that I think are very important for us. Yeah, as an immigrant myself, I have experienced immigration in my own person and within my own family. One of the things that I have also said is that being an immigrant, sometimes being pushed out of your own country and facing other communities, is like a new birth. It is as you are in the womb and then you're in the motherland, and sometimes then you are pushed out. And then when you're pushed out, you come out of that community and it's just like a baby, you need to be received and taken care of. But if there is nobody there to receive you, then something bad can go or something wrong can go with you there. And then if there's a community to receive you and to take care of you, then that just changes things for you as an immigrant. And I feel like back in the 1980s, in 1986, when I arrived in Canada, I had no English at all. We didn't know anybody in the communities there. And then also everything changed. We were Guatemala at that point in February 1986, and it was 25 degrees Celsius in Guatemala. Then we arrived in Canada at minus 25 degrees Celsius in Calgary, right, in 3 feet of snow. So then as we are coming into the airport in Toronto, they give us boots, they give us jackets, the toques and gloves, and then we walk outside into this freezer, and then so we right away as a baby, then you're just wrapped in different diapers, and then my mom is looking for food, and at that point there wasn't the ethnic aisle or the Hispanic aisle in this the stores, so then you have to go searching for black beans and for flour for the tortillas and trying to figure out how to do that. So then once again, as a baby, you start just eating something different and you have to get used to it. And then voices start coming your way and you don't understand a thing they're saying. And people think, well, they speak louder to you sometimes because they think you understand better, but it doesn't work that way. So then all these things start happening that just make you feel like a newborn. And it takes a community to receive you and to take care of you. For me, I was fortunate that and blessed that the First Hispanic Mennonite Church in Calgary embraced us and took care of us. And they were the ones who changed our diapers. And they were the ones who took us to different places. And the immigrant comes with a lot of different issues in the family. And then after a year, my mom and my dad split, and my mom went back to Guatemala. My dad stayed with the three boys. My two sisters are in Guatemala now. So I have family, two sisters in Guatemala, my mom is in Guatemala, my dad is in Vancouver, my dad, my other brother is in Calgary, my other brother is in Vancouver. So our family is all over the place. I live here in the United States. So the issue of migration separating families and these fabrics of society as well, right? But then how can the church then respond to the issues that the migrants are facing at this point and just helping with those issues? And I feel like the church at that point embraced me as a newcomer. Many times here in the United States, we talk about people living in the shadows of society, just being hidden in some ways. But I think many times we have pushed immigrants into that part because we don't embrace them in the way they are. Sometimes we want them to speak English right away. And it takes such a long time. And I realize after 27 years, I still have an accent, and it takes a long time for you to develop a way that you can speak. When you're 15 and you're trying to learn a new language, and everybody makes fun of you, and then it's just hard because then you don't want to say anything because people will laugh at you. So then it took me 4 years to actually carry a conversation with somebody in English. So are things like that, the small things like that, that we have to understand how the migrant feels and how these new babies are supposed to be taken care of if we want them to develop and to have nourishment and to nurture in a way that is good. If we want them to live in the shadows of society, then we keep pushing them down and they will be there. But then we'll face the issues in our society, in our communities, where many people will be facing issues with drugs, and then gangs are a big deal right now in our communities because those are the communities that are receiving them and giving them the embrace that we at the church and our society are not giving them. One of the problems that we're facing right now here in the United States is that in all this mess of immigration, then we find people in communities that are just against each other. And at some point, then, as peacemakers, we have to see how we build bridges among these communities. Many times during my work, I find people who think that the Border Patrol are my antagonist or they are my enemy. And at the beginning, I will have to say, yes, I encounter and I have had encounters with the Border Patrol where it was hard to deal with them. But then in the past few years, I have had experiences where I have had better encounters with the Border Patrol. And then also last year, I was in Mexico side of the border in Nogales. And as I was serving a soup kitchen breakfast, I met this man. His name was Juan. And Juan had lived here in the United States in California for 16 years. And he had already a family. His daughter and his wife were US citizens. And he was waiting for one document that didn't come in the mail or wasn't mailed the correct way. So then the immigration services came after him and he was deported. So he ended up living at the other side of the border in Nogales. And then when I found Juan there, I was serving him breakfast, then he shared his story with me. And then he told me how sometimes he will receive money from his wife. And then the Mexican police will take the money away from him, you know, just wait for him a block away and then search him and then take his money away. And then as he was going to try to cross the border, then people will take his water and then people will take his food away. And the human smuggler will just leave him in the middle of the desert. And then he had been lost a couple of days, and then the Border Patrol found him, and the officer gave him food, gave him water, healed his wounds and his feet, and then deported him. And in some ways, Juan looked at the Border Patrol officer as the Good Samaritan that truly helped him. So that started changing my perspective on how do we look at the Border Patrol as well. During that same time, then I crossed the border and I was doing a walk that is called the Migrant Trail Walk, 75 miles from Sonora in Mexico to Tucson, to bring attention to deaths of migrants in the desert. And as I was doing that walk, during a meal, a woman who was a Mexican woman, but she had lived in Tucson for a long time. Then she stood beside me, and then we started talking. And then she said, "It's a good thing what you're doing here, you know, walking to bring attention to the deaths of migrants." She says, "My son is a Border Patrol officer." And then I thought, well, this woman, she's serving food to activists who are, you know, defending the rights of migrants, but her son is a Border Patrol officer. So how could this be? So then we start talking about it. And then she says, "He's a good kid." She says, "You know, he is a good kid. He helps migrants in the desert sometimes, gives them food, gives them water, and then he helps them out. And then he has to deport them because that's his job, but then that's what he does, right?" And then, but then she says, "Every time he comes home, I ask him, 'How did it go today?' And then he always replies the same thing, 'Breaking dreams, Mom, breaking dreams, like always.'" And then you figure out that sometimes the system has pushed us to find that those enemies, but those enemies, they realize what they're doing sometimes. And at this point, the United States is spending a lot of money in immigration, in deportations, and doing a lot of enforcement of the law, but very little on fixing these laws that are broken. And it just puts our communities against each other times. So then for us as peacemakers, I think sometimes is to build those bridges, trying to figure out then where do we aim our efforts. And sometimes then looking back at the root causes of where the issues are facing. For me to go and then talk to a couple of Border Patrol officers, it probably won't change much, right? But if I continue my work and advocacy towards Washington and trying to see if the laws on immigration change here so we can be more welcoming, then I think that'll be much better and will change much more here. So my work then takes me back and again, planting those seeds in the communities, but also planting those seeds in Washington so we can change the laws that are forcing communities to be against each other here in the United States.
Impress like a mother's morning dress.